Hey, it's Molly. And to set the stage, let me take you back to just a little over 4 months ago. It's January 2022, and I was busy working on some art and other personal stuff when I get a DM from a friend linking me to a video. Backrooms, the Third Test by Kane Pixels. Now, I was definitely familiar with WebSerious, and more particularly, I was aware of the current shift that WebSerious were seeing into analog horror, pretty much taking advantage of more data technology and using it as a tool to aid in making things more... The I'd seen FNAF VHS, the Walton Files, the Monument Mythos, Mandela Catalog, the whole ordeal, but one focusing specifically on the Backrooms, that caught my eye. I always was really fond of the idea of the Backrooms, as I'm sure plenty of others were when I had that initial surge of popularity a few years back, kickstarting what would become this sort of overall appreciation for liminal spaces or weirdcore or what have you. Hell, the Backrooms even got this more expanded lore to it, having different levels and lore and other random shit added into the whole thing, but a potential web series or video specifically about the Backrooms was something that I was rather surprised to not have seen sooner. And so, I watched it, with the strange Texas speech voice narrating over diagrams and schematics of some sort of machinery, setting the scene for this being a test run of said machinery, mentioning its potential use in resolving all storage and residential needs if given proper funding by the government, and seeing this doorway thing powered on for a bit before shutting down as it started to reach its limit. It was a lot at once, and not what I expected, but the editing and overall presentation was certainly impressive, and I just wondered if this was some one-off thing, but then as I checked the recommended videos, I realized I was missing out on what would be probably one of the biggest fucking smash hits for a web series that I've seen since Marble Hornets or Petscop. In fact, over time proving to be the biggest blow-up I think I've ever seen a web series have, period. A roughly 10-minute video of Backrooms found footage. And watching that had me completely in awe. The extremely authentic look that the Backrooms has in this video, and seeing it in full motion for once, the bizarrely realistic hammer movement, the inclusion of other liminal spaces aside from the Backrooms, and whatever the fuck this thing is, I never thought I'd say it, but this legitimately fooled my brain at first into thinking that this was the real deal. Like, I knew clearly it had to be some insane stuff going on in Blender and After Effects, but I think I'm not too far off from how most other people react to seeing this video for the first time, just completely jaw-dropped. Honestly, what came to mind after seeing it was just, how did this not happen sooner? And after seeing that these two videos I watched, as well as a third unlisted one, were all put in a playlist specifically just titled The Backrooms, it became clear that whoever this guy was, he was absolutely going to turn this into something bigger. Ultimately, a web series focusing mainly on the Backrooms and possibly other liminal spaces, made as a result of scientists never stopping to ask if they should do something rather than could, and exploring the way that it affects the reality that it's housed in and just how increasingly difficult to understand it really is. And so, that takes us to several months later. I've been keeping my eye on it ever since, and I honestly wanted to make a video on it even sooner, but I wanted to also wait until there was a substantial amount of videos to where it'd be fair enough to make a decent assessment out of just what the hell is going on in this series. And I suppose now, with the latest video in the series being reported, I think there's definitely more than enough provided to where I feel like I can make a proper video trying to sink my teeth into the series as much as possible. Because while this series absolutely has had a lot of bigger channels talking about it, I don't know if I've really seen any videos actually make a comprehensive, full analysis of what we have at hand at the moment. That, and even if there is one, I feel like having everything so far packed into one thing would be pretty convenient, as things are probably going to get more complex from this point forward, and each video only raises the number of questions we have about what's going on. I want to pretty much just look through all the videos we have so far of the series, take notes on anything I see or find out within them, and after that put whatever pieces I have together and see what can and can't be answered, and make some general idea, possibly, of what the series might be really trying to get at, if anything. I'm not going to play the videos themselves in full or whatever, outside of just transcribing any dialogue that might be important, but rather just summarize what happens as concisely as I can, as if you're watching this, I'm assuming you have already watched the series for yourself, but if for some reason you haven't, I highly recommend that you do. Like, seriously, this is really good shit, and it's absolutely worth at least experiencing it yourself. Most of the videos at the moment are rather short, with the occasional longer episode, but even those have very good payoff in my opinion. I'll link it in the description either way, but I'll save the praise for towards the last like of the video. I'm also well aware that this video is likely going to be pretty dated once more episodes come out, as pretty much every video adds a lot of new information to the lore of the series, and there's definitely a lot of leads that haven't really gotten to meet their point of revealing any substantial answers yet as of the time I'm making this video, so I am more than prepared to say that I'm probably going to be wrong on a good chunk of all of this. But that doesn't stop me from wanting to at least try to see if there's anything we can infer or have answered with the information we have now. And hey, if enough episodes come out in the future, or even if it reaches a planned end at some point or whatever, I might just do more videos covering those and changing my theories around over time, but who knows, I have the fucking attention span of a goldfish sometimes when it comes to committing to certain things. But I suppose that gets the introduction out of the way. I've made my goal pretty clear, and we have a lot of shit to chew through, so let's not waste any more time. Without further ado, let's try to analyze what there is so far of The Backrooms by Kane Pixels, one video at a time. Starting with... Alright, Molly from the future here, mid-video editing. I'm putting this in advance just to clarify something because I did fuck up a little bit on a specific aspect of the analysis. Aside from the whole thing with Kane specifically stating that he's not incorporating any levels or like shit like the partygoers or whatever in the Hysterius, I've also come to learn after joining his server that he clarified specifically in the theory channel that the backrooms were found by Async. They were not created by Async, so there's a few moments where I kind of make it sound like it was made by Async, and if so, sorry. I'll try to say it's more so like I'm referring to them creating the threshold, I would say. I was like not really sure if it was created or found necessarily, but just to clarify, I know, and it doesn't completely damage my theories anyway, because it doesn't really have to do with them making the backrooms, but just letting it seep into reality, essentially. So that's all. But back to the video. The first video of the series is pretty interesting to look at in conjunction with everything else that happens after. Considering the rest of the series focuses on what happens from just Async's end, this video still feels rather self-contained, being the only instance of seeing the backrooms from the perspective of someone that really had no idea what was happening. With that in mind, the video opens with a blue screen and the sound of a tape being inserted, the beginning of said tape showing what appears to be a shot of some scene for a short film or movie of some kind outdoors. And immediately, with the appearance of the clapperboard, we see a few details. The cameraman's name appears to be Kane himself, or some in-universe version of him, and the date of the production is July 4th, 1991. This immediately raises suspicion, since the description says it was found in September 1996, an over 5-year gap in time. The film crew seems to be wrapping up their production for the day, only needing to get one more shot done before Kane ends up, well, clipping into the backrooms. And this is where the video begins proper, title card and all. Kane begins exploring the place he just found himself in, looking to see if anyone else could be around. Little does he know, there's a few instances already where we can get a little glimpse that he is, in fact, not alone, just not in the way one would hope for. But eventually, he finds arrows, writings on the walls, signs that he absolutely isn't the first person to end up here, and he begins following them, leading to a wall filled with random writings and a few drawings. Zooming in, we get a better look at some of the writing, God closed his eyes, and other cropped portions of sentences, but in particular focusing on one, don't move, stay still. And shortly after, our good old pal shows up to say hi and to chase Kane deeper into the backrooms. Since we never got a proper name for this thing, I'm going to just call it The Beast, because it's funny. While I plan to save deeper discussion of the beast for the theory section of the video, I will try to note the more obvious observations of the beast that can be made with the few total seconds we get to see it visibly. While humanoid in form, it's honestly so hard to make out many details aside from it taking on this almost stick figure-like appearance, having what looks to be wires of some kind, making out the overall form of it. Aside from that, the head is honestly the most confusing part for me to understand. It looks like almost a brain, but not quite. And as for the sounds it makes, it's eerie since it clearly is a bit human-like, but it almost sounds as if it's in pain. A cross between sounding feral and yet, again, just very human. I think it also seems to be capable of disrupting technology judging from how the camera reacts to it when near the beast. Moving forward, Kane eventually escapes the beast's grasp, falling into a hole that leads into another actually pretty familiar space, in which the video continues as a montage of Kane exploring some of our favorite liminal spaces as shown. Starting out with that one living room of a house I'm sure I've been to that one time for summer vacation like 5 years ago, and then that fucked up hotel that's like in an airport or something and has all those windows going out into, I don't know, like an indoor courtyard. It's honestly one of my favorite liminal spaces, and the fact it's actually real also baffles me. Also, wait, do you hear that? Is that? No, it can't be.
Hello, guys and gals. Welcome back this week for another episode of Haunted Games.
Nah, I'm just fucking with you. It did remind me of that a lot, though, when I first heard it, and now I can't unhear it. But anyway, after enough exploring and being completely flabbergasted at the sight of some of these places, Kane finds a door in what looks like some kind of corridor in an office building, and opening it and going up the stairs to another door leads him back where he started, pretty much. And not too long after, the camera can be heard having a bit of an audio distortion as Kane gets jump-scared by a chair, likely thrown by the beast, and finds a place to try to hide from it. As we get another good look at it, that only raises more questions about what the hell this thing is. It looks as if its torso is horribly elongated or that it's able to stretch and bend in very unnatural ways. It certainly didn't seem to look like this when it first chased Kane, so I guess it's rather flexible. And as Kane looks down into another hole into God knows where, he lets the beast sneak up on him as we finally see it real up close and... Yeah, no, I really can't tell you what the fuck this thing is even from this up close, so let's just save it for later. The camera falls out of Kane's grasp and into the pit as we see him taken by the beast for a bit, shortly before the camera clips back into reality, falling from a very large height into the ground as the video ends with a shot of the outside, possibly just before someone comes to find and pick up the camera. And that's the end of the video that got all of this started. Frankly, amazing on its own, and it still holds up really well even with the clear improvement that can be seen in the later videos of the series, but there's honestly so many questions that can be asked right away. The most obvious thing being, well, what the hell is the deal with the beast, but also, the main thing getting to me is the absurd gap in time between the date given in the description and the one we saw in the beginning of the video. How long was Kane really in the back rooms? Does time work differently in there compared to ours? Did his few hours or so of being in there equal 5 years in reality? Did he get warped in time, or did the camera just clip out of reality and time itself into some random point 5 years in the future? And aside from that, I can't help but ask the question, who actually found the footage? Like, how long did it take before someone found this camera outside? And not only that, but was there any footage that we didn't end up actually seeing? In context with the series, for all we know, maybe Async found it and cut out some stuff, or some footage was corrupted, or even an unknown party found it and knows things that they shouldn't. Either way, this footage was found, and it has its place in the actual playlist for the series, and as of the time of writing, it's still the latest point we have in the timeline of the Backroom series. There's, frankly, a lot of things that can't really be answered, as we haven't seen a lot of what may have happened after 1990 within the series itself. But it absolutely is a good start for the series, giving an idea to how it'd be like for one of who we find out to be many, many people who ended up living through this exact scenario. Only this time, there is actual recorded footage of it. And with that, I suppose that covers the found footage video. The next thing to go into would be the third test, but there is one more thing. There's a link in the description of this video, leading to another unlisted YouTube video. Let's see where this leads. This video opens with text simply saying, data not accessible, as it reformats and then opens the archive file the video title seems to refer to. Quick little tidbit as someone who is a bit of a tech nerd, sort of. A .tar file would have to refer to a tape archive file, which is an extension used for files that are mainly stored on tape drives. If you don't know what tape drives are, they're pretty much just the final boss of data storage, especially for backup, and they were mainly used a lot around the time period of most of these videos taking place. Their only issue being that while they have a shitload of storage, they do take a while to really do anything because after all, it is on tape, so it has to run through a very long reel manually to get to what you're looking for. .tar files were made for the purpose of making this a little easier, essentially compiling everything into one entity without really compressing it. That's all. But back to the video. The archive file seems to contain a bunch of photos containing the backrooms and other things. A photo of what looks like a circuit board, possibly, and photos of other strange spaces. Scientists and the like working on some machinery with their faces censored, setting up devices in an empty room, even studying the backrooms themselves from within a room looking out into a window, and this image. There's kind of a lot to unpack, but to avoid getting super deep into the mechanics of theoretical and electromagnetic physics, I'll keep it as concise as possible since this refers to a concept that's only vaguely referred to a few other times in the series at most. The image seems to visually depict an example of what might be a null zone. The smaller caption on the left reads, due to the elevation discrepancy on panels 225 and 224 or 234, a small KX field is created. Now, I tried my best to understand the potential mechanics of all of this, but to put it shortly, through some science fuckery, due to a difference in properties between these two places, going into this null zone seems to do something. One could theorize that it's a more formal way of describing a potential place for someone to clip into the backrooms, but I feel that's yet to be completely made clear at this point, at least until it's mentioned later in the series. And to end off the video, we get one last picture of a corridor of some kind. It almost looks like it leads through a doorway, possibly, with a bright light at the end. But aside from that, there's not much else to really gather from it. And, well, that's that. While it doesn't answer all of the questions from the found footage video, it does add a whole new layer. The possibility that the backrooms are not necessarily a force of nature, but rather found. The machinery we see in the video, the people in the lab coats clearly working on and studying things related to the backrooms, it all paints a picture that I frankly haven't really seen in any other interpretation of it, that it's all one giant experiment gone, more than likely, horribly wrong judging from what we saw happen in the found footage. In essence, this all but confirms that the backrooms were found by a science team or the government, which will soon learn to be very true, and this video is an archive of possibly the events of specifically March 11th, 1990. This by itself is already interesting, but there's an added detail. This archive was compiled specifically on June 1991, over a year later. I'll come back to this point later in the video. But that's the end of that. We've gotten a good glimpse of the backrooms, and we also now know a potential place from where the backrooms could have come from. And I'd say while the initial found footage absolutely set the stage for the level of quality this series was going to have, this video acts as a foundation for what perspective we're going to be seeing the rest of the series as is from. And not too long at all after the upload of these two videos, we would already start to see that foundation being built upon. The first proper video of the Backrooms series, and the video that would officially solidify this as an episodic series in the first place, this video begins with a synthesized voice immediately introducing us to the facility that seems to have started it all, the Async Foundation. At this time, though, the Backrooms had not yet been found, but rather we see graphs and diagrams and other scenes depicting machinery that we can infer would be used to open a doorway to such a place, the date provided in the description being, well, the third test of this low-proximity magnetic distortion system. And Ivan Beck is mentioned, who was vice director of the Async Foundation, and we get an idea as to the intention behind the creation of this machinery. Essentially, if it did get the proper funding, they seek to make an alternative solution to storage and residential needs, basically making it so, instead of making spaces to live in through natural resources, why not just make the funny particles vibrate so fucking fast that it just artificially makes new space for you? Surely that won't have major consequences for humanity. And right after learning this information, we do in fact see this third test for ourselves as the machine powers on, causing a blinding light to show from the other side of it. Sparks begin flying from this doorway and alarms go off, clearly showing it's already being pushed to its absolute limit, before powering back down as this video ends. The test seemed almost successful, maybe, but still doesn't seem to be quite what Async needed to get the job done. There isn't much else to really gather from this video as it's much shorter than the found footage, but it does answer a lot of questions that one might have had when watching the previous videos, and again, acts as more of a proper introduction to the group that started this whole situation to begin with. The only questions we can really get out of this are, how do they figure out that this would be a good idea, and also how do they get their hands on this kind of tech in the first place? But overall, I feel this video is more of a tone setter than anything, and while this time around they didn't get what they were looking for, surely one of these attempts had to go right. And it wouldn't be long either before we see that being the case. This video opens immediately with a warning from the FBI. Nice. Seems like the government became a little more interested with Async's idea in between the last video and this one. We see this is now the sixth test of the magnetic distortion system that we saw in the last video, as well as something censored in parentheses next to it. Now, a lot of information is going to hit us all at once within a very short time frame, so I'm going to be as quick as possible with explaining it. We see a lot of spinning machines that seem to be part of the whole operation needed to make the distortion system work as intended, and then a list of modifications made to said system since the last test. A new support beam was added to the machine, and 13 RF cavities were added to it, which essentially aid in speeding up the process of accelerating particles. Something else was introduced to the system that was left completely censored and in red for some reason. Some detectors were replaced, and now the system can monitor for an even higher particle vibration speed than before. And then we get whatever the fuck this is. This image is reversed, and flipping it, we get a strange sequence of letters, symbols, and numbers, and the word failure repeated 3 times. And at the top, we see DNCH/DY=8000. If you were like me, you probably thought this was a link to another unlisted video, but it does not really look like an average video link at all, and it doesn't even meet the exact 11 character requirement, so what the hell is this? Looking up this exact string, the best thing I could find was a study on a large ion collider experiment, or ALICE, which was meant to study the physics of strongly interacting matter and the quark gluon plasma in nucleus-nucleus collisions. This plasma refers to a state of matter where particles are pretty much freed under their attraction under absurd amounts of energy densities, and it is also literally the hottest thing ever created on Earth, apparently, 100,000 times hotter than the center of the sun. And looking into it, the string we got seems to be pretty much an equation? DNCH/DY would refer to charged particle multiplicity density, which I guess explains itself. It's the density that results from a shitload of charged particles. And in the study that I found, it does specifically refer to this exact equation as the performance that was checked by the detectors in detailed simulations. Hell, the next frame even seems to confirm that this is what this equation came from, as it shows an edited crop of some kind of schematics with labels for specific parts. This by itself is nothing to pay attention to, but looking at the study I found again, while the labels are modified in the video, it actually has the almost exact schematics that were used in the video, which I found to be a pretty neat discovery. But with all of this in mind, why did I just tell you all of this information about a particle accelerator that I found the study for on the internet? Well, I don't think the importance of it really has to do with the exact science or theory behind it, but rather in conjunction with the word failure in this frame. Remember, the equation referred to the highest amount that the detectors were checked in simulations, and it only was really optimized for half of that amount. So what I think this is trying to get across is, even this probably absurdly high amount of density was not sufficient enough for Async to get the results they wanted, and they had to aim even higher than this. So in essence, I interpret this at least as trying to put into a more realistic scope just how much Async had to manipulate the fabric of reality in order to make something like the Backrooms happen. Or at least that's my best guess as to what the hell is going on with this single frame. Moving on though, more machinery is shown, as well as a small graph of something in the corner that I frankly can't make much out of, but then we see another shot of the doorway from the last video, as the sixth test of the distortion system begins. As seen before, the machine already appears to be hitting its limit, beginning to shake the whole area, but it does not power down at any point as debris starts falling into the room and an alarm goes off once again, before cutting off into another perspective. A scientist urges someone else to shut down the machine as we see an image begin to form in the center, looking almost like a layout for a maze, likely a map of the backrooms themselves unfolding right in front of us. Other scientists question what's happening as one of them sees something on the other side of the machine, deciding to push further despite the clear safety hazard. And we cut back to another shot of the machine, about 10 minutes since the test started. The room is in shambles, but there it is. Through the other side of the doorway, we can see the backrooms. The test was messy, but it seems it was a success after all. They finally got what they were looking for, and that's all that matters. And the video ends. But, well, there is something else. Let's see this from another point of view. On October 17th, 1989, at 5:04 p.m., a 6.9 magnitude earthquake struck the central north coast of California, causing significant damage in Santa Cruz County especially. This earthquake in particular may be more well known for the fact that it occurred during a national live broadcast of the year's MLB World Series Championship, even being referred to as the World Series Earthquake. Power was out in certain areas for several hours, possibly even days for some. A section of the Nimitz Freeway in Oakland collapsed, causing a large chunk of casualties and injuries. And the World Series was halted, needing to be delayed 10 days, the longest in the World Series' history, before it could finish its games. Had it not been for the lighter traffic as a result of the World Series taking place and more people staying home to watch it, even more lives likely would have been lost. This is a real event that happened, there's a whole Wikipedia article written about it and everything, but you might notice this date correlates with the one given in the previous video, and this one that we're on now is simply a montage of news reports showing what I just described. It really says everything that needs to be said without saying anything at all. This is real, but in the context of this series, this was no ordinary earthquake. This was not by natural means, but rather a result of Async pushing their experiment to the absolute limit. And with the title of the video being collateral.mov, I feel it's pretty obvious what the point of this video really is. And frankly, it's still one of my favorite videos from the whole series thus far just for the concept alone. Async did get what they were looking for, but in doing so, the immediate consequences caused severe damages to so many people and so much property and put major events at the time in that area to a complete halt as a result. Of course, it's easy to just cover this up as a simple natural disaster, but it is still a massive amount of losses that resulted from how far Async went to make the backrooms happen. And frankly, I think this is what kept me so hooked onto the series and its early videos on top of the insane production quality. There's no better way to keep your audience immersed than pretty much tying real-world events or concepts into your work because it gives you a genuine scale to compare the events of the series to. This real earthquake that happened? That's how much Async had to push their technology to meet their goals. This insane amount of density that was just thrown in as a single-frame message in the previous video? That's a more proper scope for the viewer to look through to at least somewhat understand how absurdly far the goalpost was and how it exceeded anything that would be reasonable by a reality's standards. It's not necessarily the essentials of this series, and these details didn't really need to be sprinkled into this extent. You don't need to know this stuff to enjoy the series, but it does go to show how much it helps you understand the scope of what's happening, and it's a level of detail I really can't help but appreciate. That what Async did really had real consequences and was beyond anything we actually discovered at that time. And this theme would act as a pretty good bridge into the next video, as we were about to learn that, of course, the consequences of Async's discovery of the backrooms did not stop there. Months have passed since the opening of the backrooms, and missing persons cases have skyrocketed since. We see several posters with names: Nicholas Bolton, Margaret Watson, an unnamed individual, a 2-year-old named Ellis White, and Janice Scott. We see on a graph too that these cases are predicted to get even higher into the later years of the decade before seeing a shot of the gateway into the backrooms and cutting out to another perspective. We're now looking from the view of a group of individuals in what I can best assume are hazmat suits of some kind, one of which carrying a red line or tape with them to make sure the crew doesn't get lost. The crew continues walking before stopping after turning a corner and finding a dead body at the end of the room, it and the wall near it being covered in some dark substance or mold. I tried to get the best transcript that I could of what the team says at the moment, but if anyone can get a better idea of what's being said, let me know in the comments or something.
Stop. Hold it. I don't know. I've never seen this like that. It may just be part of the environment. But it makes no sense. Why would I be able to complete with you? This makes no sense. This wasn't in the last report.
No, this is definitely new.
It's organic. It's some kind of fungus.
It's pretty clear that this was just some poor soul that clipped into here, judging from the casual clothes they're wearing. Even one could theorize that this might be Nicholas Bolton, as some of the clothing in comparison is kind of similar, but I don't know for sure, and even if it is true, I'm not sure what could really be done with that information, though it would be a really neat touch if this is the case. But this footage is suddenly cut off as we see microscopic images of some bacteria or fungus, and then a blue screen with reverse text that, when flipped, simply says, "If anybody, blame him." This immediately raises a metric fuck ton of questions, as this is the first time we've seen a video be blatantly interfered with a stated message like this. Of course, what I first wonder is who exactly is saying this and who is this directed at. The most obvious guess would be that it's referring to the corpse found in the video, but that makes me wonder, what the hell did a dead body do to fuck things up that badly? It could also be referring to someone like Ivan Beck or a higher up within Async. And as for who could have left this message, well, that's something to be saved for later. The main point is, this video seems to show something that probably has happened to a lot of people that end up in the backrooms, being killed by some sort of fungal disease, either caused by the backrooms themselves or perhaps by the beast. And this also raises another thing to take into account, which is the physical qualities of the backrooms themselves. And in a way, I feel it definitely adds to the whole point of the video that I interpret, which is that this is just what we saw for one person. Going back to the beginning of the video, there are a ton of people who ended up in this situation already, probably. Hell, again, a fucking 2-year-old clipped into the back rooms, and the worst part is, even though they clearly do leave a mark of their death, and there can still be signs of people having been here, chances are the space they've found is so huge they likely wouldn't even be found by anyone. At least, not for a very long time. While a lot of questions can be asked about what really happened to this one person, I feel it also does a great job at showing that finding the backrooms has caused even more trouble well after the earthquake that it took in the previous main video. With that said, though, the team also clearly didn't expect to find a whole-ass corpse here, and we also don't know all too much about what's going on in the first place with Async sending teams of people to explore them in this manner. It seems that this is likely the perspective that we'll often see from this point forward in regards to anything happening directly in the backrooms, so I wonder what else is going on now that they've opened the gates to liminal space hell. Now, immediately, before even going into the video, there is something very much wrong here. The date assigned to this video is February 29th, 1990. This is a bit of a problem because this date does not exist. 1990 was not a leap year, therefore February only ended up on the 28th that year. Huh. Going into the video, though, things start with an immediate warning that this video is for internal use only. Pretty standard stuff, I'd imagine, at this point. And more properly, we see that this is an introduction to an instructional video about this whole ordeal that Async has gotten themselves into, aimed especially for people whose job is to explore and report things happening within the backrooms. We see some more official terminology being used here. This whole thing has been dubbed as a Project KV-31, referring to the overall study and development of the Low Proximity Magnetic Distortion System, or, more officially, we see that the doorway-looking thing that created a gateway into the backrooms is formerly known as the Threshold. We then get some alternative names for what the project is called internally, making sure to specify that they are not to be used outside of Async, and then... oh! More interference. This time we get another glimpse of what looks like a top-down map of the backrooms, and we get more reverse text that says, not that it would do any good, but people... and it's cut off after that, so it's not really clear what was going to be said there. We come back to the main video as it seems to have skipped to the portion involving safety regulations that should be followed when entering the Threshold, before cutting off once again into another recording of a team of people from Async going out to explore, the back rooms. And once again, showing a date that literally does not exist, or at least, if it does, it really would only exist in this series' universe and not ours. It would be especially strange on Async's part to show this date if it goes by the same calendar rules that ours does. Now, I'm gonna say, I spent a while trying to get a proper transcript for what they say in this video, but it was way too muffled for me to really get anything vital. I have bits and pieces, but it's nothing that really seems to make any sense to me, so if anyone has an actual transcript that they can make for what they say in these first few minutes of the video, please feel free to throw it in the comments, it'd be much appreciated. I'm sure it's not anything too crazy, but even the smallest details could mean something for all we know. This team continues exploring the back rooms until the cameraman turns a corner and hears the chattering of random people in another hallway nearby. He calls for the other people within the team, before going in to check out the source of the sound himself. And before his very eyes, as he's asking if the rest of the team can hear the chatter, to no real reaction, the team just... vanishes. Red line and all. The cameraman immediately starts to panic as he realizes he's now alone in the backrooms and has no way of reliably knowing how to get back. It might be possible that this is one of the null zones that was referred to way back in the tape archive video, as it seems that even though he entered the area, the rest of the team seemed to ignore him as if his voice wasn't really escaping the space that he just entered. That, and it's not really clear whether this is just the backrooms emulating the sound of people, or if it's a case of not just people clipping into the backrooms, but sound waves too. Going forward, the cameraman finds a strange room, looking to have fenced off stairs and shelves or something on the back end of it, as well as what looks like more of a dark something on the ground, which to me looks like something that's shattered or was burnt into pieces, judging from how it's arranged. I have no way of really knowing just what this could have been though, but it's a sign of something or someone else definitely being here in the past. And cutting to the next part, he finds a dark opening in the back of a hallway leading into another sort of liminal space, this time with odd wallpaper of trees and the like before finding an axe, a cart, and other wooden items, before finding what looks like either an actual house or a wallpaper of a house, and what sounds like... snoring? This part is especially odd, it's like the backroom's trying to make its interpretation of what a house outside in the woods would look like, and it still perplexes me honestly that it's just... here. But finally, after enough walking around, he does find his way back to where the threshold is, except now it looks more like an entrance to a lab room? Wasn't it just completely open before? When the hell did this pop up? And after entering the room, an alarm goes off shortly after, probably a result of motion detection within the room, before the video cuts out to showing more diagrams of the threshold and what looks like a top-down layout for the room that we just saw. Ending the video there. There was a lot more blatant summarizing for this video, especially I'm aware, but it does raise a lot of questions either way. Judging from how the cameraman came back to the same spot that he was when he first left, except now with the addition of a whole room around the exit of the threshold, it seems that the most likely thing one can infer is that the team didn't disappear, but rather that he did. And not only that, but he actually got jumped forward in time. How far exactly, though, is very unclear at the moment. But now aside from the factor of people clipping into the backrooms, we have a better idea of how it makes the flow of time unstable, possibly depending on if you enter any of the aforementioned null zones, which we still don't know the full idea of yet. But, well, that's that. While it does raise a lot of new questions, there's still only so much that can really be answered, and it becomes only more clear that there is a lot to the backrooms that is yet to be understood or accounted for, even despite the information that we have right now about the potential dangers of it. A picture can slowly start to be painted about the only increasing amount of confusion that comes with trying to understand the properties of the backrooms, even with everything that Async has done so far to try to comprehend what they've made. And it seems as if this is only going to become more clear with the next video we're about to see. As the title implies, this video focuses on an autopsy report for a John Doe, or unnamed individual. Not too long into the video, we get a visual of the person who has had this report done on them, and looking at some of the vague similarities this body has, mainly in clothes and in their damages to the one we saw at the end of Missing Persons, as well as seeing how close the date of this video is to that one, it seems most likely that this is the same individual we saw at the end of Missing Persons. And it seems only more likely as we see a shot of the scene where the body was found, and it definitely matches up with that video. We learn that the subject was male, somewhere between 18 and 21 years old, and might have died 5 days prior due to malnutrition, but it's only a guess due to the damages the individual sustained. And right after is where we get the really weird shit. We see a shot of the person's kidney, which looks completely fucked up, as we learn the decomposition process was stunted in some areas, but not in others. When taking a sample of some of the material found from the decomposition, a few specific names are thrown around, but looking into it, both Pseudomonas fluorescens and Hay bacillus are normal bacteria that can be found in the digestive tract, the former of which could mainly cause problems in having bacteria appear in your blood circulation, but the latter being, well, as the pathologist describes, more often than not completely harmless. But either way, there's no way of knowing if what he found even was either of these things, and this seems like another instance of just frankly having no fucking clue what happened or how to make any sense of it, which the pathologist's lack of certainty as to what to make of his findings seems to only aid in. The pathologist then, in a question to him, reveals that Ivan Beck was the person that he's been talking to, asking where the subject came from before cutting out to another shot. We now see a TV turn on and flip through several different images, sounds, videos, repeating on occasion and showing some things we've already seen and some things that we haven't. One of the images shows some handwriting and the words are hard to make out, but I've seen it theorized to say contract termination, which would imply that the government must have backed out of giving Async any further funding, possibly after seeing some of the trouble that they've caused with their project. And the last image we see before seeing a prolonged shot of the threshold sticks out to me a little. It's a crop of some excerpt that seems to talk about the Backrooms, but in a much more demeaning manner, and in a way that only further confirms something about the series that I'll get to after summarizing everything. But it specifically seems to refer to this whole project as a sort of mistake, possibly? Meaning, with the mentioning of this environment not being suited for mankind, the best guess I have for this being a letter that would probably suggest that the project be shut down in some way due to all of the oddities that have happened since its
discovery.
But the video does end either way with a shot of the threshold as distorted music plays, only further setting the tone that even despite everything that has been seen, chances are this is still not even scratching the surface of what Async is yet to discover about their creation. Starting off, we see that a room is now being constructed in the immediate area that surrounds the exit of the threshold. This seems to more likely confirm something that was speculated only a few videos ago with the person that got lost in the back rooms. Considering that informational video took place only days before this, and on March 5th they've only begun the construction of the room, it's clear that the person from the former video absolutely got jumped forward in time, though it's still not certain to what point exactly he was sent to. That, and to my knowledge, only one threshold actually exists that we've seen, and looking at the layout of the back rooms in both videos where this room is, it's pretty much identical. There isn't a second threshold for them to build a different room from, so this definitely has to be the same one. We see through a text graphic that while the room is undergoing construction, Async has placed 7 cameras around the general area to capture any potential motion or noise that might occur during their time away from the room itself. Things stay pretty straightforward, so I suppose the summary for this will follow suit. We see a compilation of all alerts received on the night, but again, bringing up the date of informational video, this specific detail of mentioning the day of March 5th as on a Monday also perplexes me. If February 29th was a date that actually existed on this year, in this universe, surely March 5th would be on a Tuesday and not a Monday, right? So with the train of logic that I'm going by, this would mean that in the context of this series, February 29th really did not exist in this world either, which further makes its appearance on informational video only more confusing. Long story short, bitch is flabbergasted. Going back to the video, the first few alerts are normal. Just some researchers going to and back on an exploration of the back rooms and a supervisor passing one of the cameras before the sound of the threshold barrier closing can be heard as a fourth alert. Then things get weird. The first sound that has yet to be determined seems most like just clanging of metal of some kind, but it's hard to make out much else. After that, one of the cameras suddenly suffers a microphone failure which triggers an alert. Not sure if someone forgot to give this thing new batteries, or if it's yet another instance of the backrooms refusing to make any goddamn sense. And then, in the next alert, we see some motion. Taking a closer look at it, the details I can best make out are two possibilities. The first and most straightforward thing is that this is a monster or beast of some kind, but I doubt that this is the beast that we saw in the found footage. I could be wrong, but something about what we do see of it just feels like it's not quite as stick-like as the beast looks, and the way we never see it make contact with the ground at all is unlike what we saw in the found footage. That, and if this part of it is its head, it looks nothing like the beast, because in the found footage its head is much different in shape and it doesn't have those two parts sticking out like that from it. The other possibility, and the one that I feel is more likely, is that those are possibly human legs floating in the air, as well as an arm poking out for a bit before the form is obscured by one of the pillars, and there's no further elaboration on it after the upscaling of the video as it just ends at that point. It's very hard to tell if it's grabbed by something or if this form is literally just floating in the air or stuck to the ceiling, but either way, it seems pretty unmistakable to me that this is a human form from what can be seen of it. My best guess is that this might be actually someone who did clip into the backrooms, but I can't tell if they were already floating before turning the corner, or if they like clipped in from the ceiling or something. This does seem to just be some guy though, just somehow suspended in the fucking air. I really can't say much more than that, but this video is yet another instance of a concept that seems to be repeating since several videos ago. There are a lot of things in the videos that have been left completely unexplained or without elaboration up to this point. People randomly clipping into the back rooms, with the best guess being a theory about it having null zones. The appearance of dead bodies that somehow have stunted decomposition and unknown bacteria and qualities that make understanding their deaths incredibly difficult. Places that seem to emulate certain aspects of our reality, but very bizarrely so. Random sounds being heard with no explanation. The potential for the backrooms to send you to a different point in time entirely. People apparently fucking floating for some reason. While I want to save my theory on all of this for a later point, I do feel like if there is any consistent thread to follow these videos through with, it's that everything happening since the discovery of the backrooms has been only proving further its sheer lack of predictability or abiding by anything that we have come to understand as people. And not only that, but every video only seems to raise more questions while answering very little of the ones we already have so far. Just when you think something about this couldn't get any weirder, it somehow finds a way to prove you wrong. And honestly, in a way, I see these last four videos especially as almost its own arc, a way of establishing just how little Async seems to really know of what they have
found
with this project. And I'm sure it's only going to get even weirder from here. After all of this stuff has been happening and we still haven't even seen the beast from the original found footage again, not even once. Hell, we still haven't even seen anything past 1990, aside from the tape archive video and the found footage. But before seeing what is to come after the last few videos we just took a look at, the next upload takes an unexpected shift, far in the opposite direction. So remember when I said that Async was apparently where all of this seemed to start? That was a fucking lie. Here's a video showing where everything really began, with no mention of Async whatsoever. We see a shot of the outdoors before a view of a lab and then a close-up of an orb or marble of some kind, surrounded by what looks like a bunch of tubes waiting to be activated, likely to emit electromagnetic energy, before seeing that this is what looks to be a demonstration video, courtesy of Oak Ridge National Laboratory, which is a real scientific research center under government funding. We also see below that it is under the supervision of a Philip R. Heyman. Another small detail apparently is the tubes that surround the orb actually seem to match up pretty similarly to what an actual generator of that sort would look like, which is pretty neat. But leaving that aside, this video really just explains itself. Considering the super short length, the machine powers on as this looks to be a very early concept for a magnetic distortion system, as the beams activate and create a bright light at the center, and while it might be difficult to tell due to the lower quality, when the machine powers off, the orb in the center appears to be gone. A breakthrough. While only just an orb disappeared, this was the thing that officially proved that this technology can work. And we could only assume with what we have currently of the series that from here, Isig must have picked up on what happened and decided to take it a step further, leading to what would eventually become the threshold and
the discovery of the backrooms. Holy shit, Molly.
And that's that. This is by far the shortest video of the series, so there's really no further comment there, but it's a nice detour into what is currently the earliest point we have of the Backrooms timeline. When I originally took the notes for this video, this was going to be the last video to summarize, but then just a few days ago, as of writing the script, we got hit with what is now the currently longest video of the series, clocking in at a solid 14 minutes, so let's see what this last one has in store for us. Our first sight is the appearance of the date of recording, as well as the name of the cameraman for this video, Marvin E. Lee. Marvin and company are shown getting ready to put on their suits before going out into the back rooms, and we get the names of two more members of this specific team, Mark and George. There's also a fourth female member of the team, but I don't believe she is mentioned by name here. We can also see them leave into a now complete version of the room we saw in informational video and being built in motion detected. To go back to what happened in informational video, my best guess now is that at the earliest, the cameraman in that video must have came back sometime in late April or early May, but he also could have come back really any time after that. But we do at least have a point A to go to for some idea as to how far into the future he was sent. With that mentioned, the team goes out and does what we've seen a few times already, and now we can actually discern more of the conversation they have along the way. Marvin passively asks about a vertical expansion, and if it had gone through yet, before the rest of the team mentions some sort of tour or presentation that Async is doing and plans to finish first before getting to said expansion. What this vertical expansion is exactly is beyond me, honestly. The team continues exploring, now with the Backrooms adventure line to accompany them, and they eventually find yet another liminal oddity. A room filled with a bunch of holes that lead to who knows where, separated only by thin walkways, with the other end of the room having a door that's yet to be opened. The team makes a reckless decision to try to walk the thin paths to the door, as they think a walkway would be redundant.
You need to cover all the way over there. Assembling a walkway would be redundant. Well, we know it's just
Mark does make his way to the door, opening it and being rather taken aback by what they see at the other side, asking for Marvin to make his way over and record footage of what was found. Marvin does so, but before much else happens, yet another moment of interference with reverse text. Been a bit since that happened. This time, reading what looks like something that might have been pulled from some other source, simply saying, "While data could be inferred from these readings, nobody knew what would actually be found on the other side." No further comment on this, honestly. It could really be referring to anything, but most likely to what was seen on the other side of that door. But just after that distortion, Marvin stumbles and falls into one of the pits, thankfully only sustaining some minor damage and finding himself in what looks like more of the back rooms, but now with a slightly greener wallpaper. He can't physically jump back into the opening he fell from, so he's left to only wait until the rest of the team can get him back out through some means. But while waiting, Marvin suddenly hears yelling coming from one of the corridors. Despite the rest of the team insisting that he stay where he was, Marvin goes into the corridor and eventually through a gap where he finds himself in what looks to be the Backrooms' interpretation of a neighborhood at night. He continues forward as the voice asks if anyone can hear them, and still ignores the team's warnings to stay back near where he first fell, and this is where Marvin says this.
But what if Miller's right about the null zones?
This is the first time I think the null zones have been actually mentioned by anyone outside of the Tamed Archive video, and in conjunction with the voice that Marvin hears, I think it becomes pretty obvious to infer what a null zone actually is now. It seems to be Async's, or more specifically this Miller's, theory of certain places in the backrooms where people might be warped into from, and while it does seem rather obvious judging from the name and what we already know of them, having that confirmation definitely does help further cement the idea that Async does know that people are ending up here, but the idea of the no-zone seems to be more of a theory rather than known fact. Would make sense though, since the general science seems to be that objects or even people can be teleported into a different reality through electromagnetic fields, as we saw in Prototype for instance. The video continues as Marvin calls back at whoever the person yelling might be, eventually entering a house where the source of the yelling is. I've tried to understand what exactly is being said by the voice in some parts, but it's hard to make out with all the reverb and echo. But it becomes pretty clear that it's repeating, almost cycling through different screams and sentences.
What was that?
That was what?
Marvin continues through a room with fucked up turn signs and then through a winding corridor as his comms start freaking out for a moment and other things play through for a moment before going back to normal. And sadly, I didn't download the original version of the video before I got this part trimmed, so you'll just have to believe me, but for a few moments, as other random things play through the comms, I swear to God a snippet of Kids by MGMT plays through them, and I can only really catch, like, the beginning and tail end of the snippet. But I imagine it was cut out of the video due to getting copyright ID'd. Predictable YouTube. But it is definitely an interesting detail, considering that song didn't come out until, like, 2007, adding merit to the idea of the Backrooms kind of existing in multiple points of time at once, being able to pull things from different time periods through some means. Eventually, though, comms go back to normal as Marvin finds... Fuck, they got my Man Allen tutorial. You really can't have shit in the Backrooms. Jokes aside, though, there's random objects lying about that seem to imply that someone was living here, as Marvin says to the team, before the yelling occurs once again, now sounding much closer than before. Marvin turns the corner, calling out to the voice as it's saying stuff to itself that I frankly can't really make much sense of, but once he zooms in, well, there it is. The second ever official appearance of the Beast. It turns out the Beast was actually mimicking different human voices this whole time, and as it makes contact with Marvin, it begins screaming and chasing him. It screams, this time sounding even more human-like and in pain than they did in the original found footage, as Marvin bolts out of the room and back to the opening that he first fell into this place from. Thankfully being able to outrun it and have the team send him some means to get back up to the opening, and the video ends. And so does... finally. The summary and basic analysis of every single video in the series up to this point. It seems that this is the first instance of Async actually discovering the Backrooms Beast, and there is a lot gained from this video, including more clarification on what the no-zones could be, more of a better idea as to what the Beast is and what it can do, and also yet another interruption from whatever it is that's been adding this reverse text into some of the videos. That and... we also have no idea what the hell Mark found at the other side of that door. There's just a lot. And there's still so many questions that are yet to be answered, even with this video being the most abundant, probably, in content and runtime thus far. But hey, we're done with summarizing everything, and I've made all the individual observations that I felt were necessary. Let's take a step back and try to piece all of this together. Sadly, I could not get the audio or this video overall finished before Kane uploaded yet another new episode, in fact not just one, but technically two new videos. I did take this into account though, and so I decided that in such an event, I'll just add my summaries of the new episodes to the video anyway, because I do want this to be relatively up to date with the latest video as of the time this one is uploaded. I do want to be as quick as possible though, because at this point, I just want to make the fucking video, so let's just get to it, and in fact, this should be relatively easy since I believe these two new uploads actually strengthened some of my theories I ended up crafting, and there isn't a horribly large amount of new lore in either video. So, let's just see what these new uploads have for us. Right away, we can tell this video takes place directly after the events of Pitfalls, judging from the date, and there is also a noticeably much more cinematic feel to this video compared to most of the ones we've seen so far. This new upload begins with an audio recording we heard in Pitfalls, reliving the exact moment in which Marvin saw the Beast, as we see it's being played back on reel-to-reel tape. Async, unsurprisingly, has taken notice of what happened pretty quickly. We then see a shot of the team returning to the threshold, and I believe for the first time in the series since the found footage, we see real people, in the shot of a man on the other side of the room who I could best assume to be a supervisor or some higher up, I think. I don't know, this guy's a fucking magician, maybe his CGI has really gotten that realistic. Small note as well, checking the community tab teasers, one of them does show an Async ID card with the face covered with a pen and the name Anthony Dawkins printed on it. Now, I'm just making a guess, but taking a really close look at the ID card in this shot, I'm led to believe, judging from the similar clothing and the ID photo, kind of, that the man we're looking at here is in fact Anthony Dawkins, but I could be wrong. Moving on though, we see a shot of a scientist walking down a hallway and into an elevator, while cutting to a few other scientists plugging a camera into a TV and playing back the footage that we saw in Pitfalls, getting to the part where Marvin saw the beast. Unsurprisingly, the scientists are completely taken aback at the sight of this thing. We then see the first scientist walking up to a phone and calling someone, saying something that's not really made audible, and I don't know if it's worth the effort exactly to read his lips to try to get what he's saying necessarily. I'm assuming though the scientist also saw the footage and is probably calling a higher up to inquire on what the fuck he just witnessed. And then we see images of the general route the crew from Pitfalls took, getting to the part with the reel of red tape. This part of the backrooms is then seen getting boarded up before seeing schematics of new machinery and then ending with a shot of an electrician's testing a new mechanism that closes one of the windows in the lab room. It's safe to assume that this is Async's immediate response to what they saw in Pitfalls, sealing off that part of the backrooms and ensuring that even if the beast did escape up to this floor and break through the wall, that there would be a way to prevent it from seeing any trace of someone from Async. There isn't that much more to this video, as I feel what happens in it, as well as the much more cinematic feel of this episode, is made to be a tone setter of sorts, but it definitely adds a new layer to things, as it shows that Async definitely did not take this lightly, and there's an overall feeling of this video being a turning point for the series at large. Async now has to handle things a little differently than maybe they thought they could from this point forward, since before now they had no idea something like this was even lurking in there. It's a really cool look at how things play out behind the scenes at Async, and honestly, as much as I like the quality of the videos being in tapes, I also really love the more grand scope of videos like this. Like, if this is the direction that Kane aims on taking the series towards in the future, I really wouldn't mind at all. I think this video also just totally nails it in its own way. With that said, there isn't really much more to gain. We now know how Async immediately responded to seeing Pitfalls, but who knows if this is the end of their project or if this is effectively their band-aid solution to try to work around it and continue their project anyway, despite now having to account for the beast. I'd say this is it, but something happened with this video that actually hasn't happened since First Contact. There's an unlisted video in the description this time. So I guess let's just see what this leads to. This video beats Prototype for shortest episode in the series, running only 33 seconds long. Holy shit. And the contents are just as brief, but certainly not lacking in implications. We sadly don't have a date for this video. It could have happened on May 6th as well, but there's no way of knowing for sure, and I suppose it's not something of importance necessarily. We just see a shot of a camera feed at a highway as ambience plays over it. Things seem normal before the video zooms on the right-hand side and we see a fucking car clip through the floor and most likely into the back rooms. And that's it. This essentially confirms that yes, the backrooms can really just have anything clip into it. People, cars, sounds, other objects. Hell, for all we know, maybe that neighborhood from Pitfalls was literally just pulled from reality. Maybe entire spaces or buildings can be pulled into it. It's just another instance of how incomprehensible the backrooms are in its nature. Which, this alone is definitely interesting, but there is something to address. There had to be a reason why this video specifically was linked to Report, like the other enlisted videos were linked, and I think so far, all of this has to do with perspective. The tape archive video served to add more context to what we saw in the found footage, setting the foundation for what the series would be focusing on, and from what perspective. Collateral.mov show the direct consequences of Async's testing of their project, using a real-world event to put into perspective how far they had to push themselves to make the backrooms happen. And this one... well, let's look at the title first. It's just a random string of numbers, but throwing it into Google, we see that this is an ISBN or a book code, essentially, for a novella written by Charlotte Perkins Gilman in 1892 called The Yellow Wallpaper. I'm not gonna go over every event in the book, but long story short, This is a novella that centers around a woman narrator and her husband, John, who happens to also be her doctor, settling in a house for summer vacation. It essentially plays out as a secret journal, displaying her mental deterioration as a result of John putting her through a resting care treatment due to her mentioning of her nervous depression and her worries in general. And a resting care treatment is essentially some dumbass deciding, oh hey, you know what will cure depression? Fucking put this bitch in a bedroom for 2 months in a complete isolation and make sure she can't work or do anything creatively stimulating. Yeah, no wonder she went insane, but as she loses it towards the end of the novella, she makes comments about her bedroom, which she assumed to be originally a nursery maybe, having this yellow wallpaper that she's revolted by, but grows an unhealthy obsession with over the course of the novella, even seeing a pattern behind the main one that she thinks has another woman trapped in it. By the end of it, she ends up ripping and biting the wallpaper apart to free the woman that was trapped inside of it, and then only losing it more as she sees more of those same women, even seeing herself as one of the women trapped in the wallpaper. And that's pretty much the gist of it. It's essentially a critique on the resting care treatment, keeping in mind this was written at a time where that was almost legitimately considered a way to cure mental illness, and it also has themes of repressing self-expression and critiquing the position of women in marriage. But what the hell does this have to do with the back rooms, aside from obviously it also having yellow wallpaper? Well, this is where I think the connection between this video and report can be made. I think this title is meant to imply that the relationship between the narrator of this novella and John is not too unlike that between the common people and Async. Think of it this way. Async sought to make a solution to a problem involving residential needs for the common person. They found the back rooms, but much like the resting care treatment, it ultimately had been causing more harm than good, except where the resting care deteriorated the narrator's mind, the back rooms is deteriorating reality itself, trapping people, objects, pretty much anything within it, and making them suffer as well. And another connection to make, which I think is what connects these two videos, is that John, in the novella, actually notices the narrator's fixation on this yellow wallpaper, but he doesn't actually bother to repaper the room so as not to entertain her worries. He essentially turns a blind eye to it, and even thinks that the treatment is working. Sort of like how Async has been not necessarily turning a blind eye to the problems of the backrooms, but even with what they are doing in response, they're still going along with the project, at least it seems like so. They did board up the wall where the beast could potentially come from, but I see that as ultimately more like a band-aid solution. Just like that earthquake in First Contact, they can cover it up and forget that it was on their part, but it still happened regardless. The beast is still out there, the backroom still makes as little sense as it did when they first
found
it, and people and even objects are still going missing. It might be the best that they can really do, understandably, but the truth of the matter seems to stay the same. I feel this video is meant to put into perspective that even with Async's response to seeing pitfalls, things are only growing more unstable, and this is still not the end of the shit that's coming Async's way. And I think that with that, I can now properly get to taking a step back and analyzing the series as a whole with what we have so far. Thankfully, I won't need to change much from before, since, as you're going to see, I think these two new videos actually strengthen some of my theories about what I think this series is really trying to hone in on. This isn't really in the script, but I kind of went through all of this without really bothering to mention that I'm doing all of this analysis going solely off of what we see in the videos. I know there's like probably a bit of a misinterpretation that this is like an adaptation of the idea of levels or different floors within the back rooms, but from what I've heard, Kane has like made sure to clarify that this is entirely his own adaptation of the back rooms, and there isn't really any mention of floors or anything that like you can just find on like a wiki doc or something. So we have to go into this assuming that this is like an entirely unique adaptation and not really based off of anything else. So with that, I'll get into the analysis proper. So, I think the first thing to do if you want to get a good picture of what to really take away from this series so far is to ask some of the most important questions we can with all of the information we have at the moment. There's a lot of things that I addressed here and there within the videos themselves, but here is where we can start being more broad and looking at this from the perspective of the series at large. So, here's the questions that I feel are most important to ask. What exactly are the rules that the Backrooms go by? Who was leaving the reverse text messages in the videos? What actually kills the people who get lost in the Backrooms? What even is the Beast, and why or how did it end up here? And where might things be headed in the future? I think to start off, let's go over what we know the Backrooms has been capable of doing over the course of the series. There are a lot of aspects to the Backrooms in this series that all follow a general thread of, at least mostly, trying to emulate or pull things from our own reality, from what I can gather. For instance, aside from the appearance of the Backrooms themselves, we know that it is capable of creating other liminal spaces. And while in the found footage, one might have just seen this as a homage to other popular liminal spaces, I feel these fit in rather well with the way that these other spaces try to emulate our reality. There are already a few places, for example, that seem to emulate either a neighborhood or a house in the middle of the woods, or at least it tries its best to do so, still not perfectly emulating it and causing this uncanniness in execution. Look at this shot, for example, in informational video. The wallpaper here is supposed to be of trees and nature, but as the cameraman gets closer to the wall of the house and these random objects drawn about, you can see the wallpaper just becomes this mess of different colored lines. It kind of just looks like a PS1 texture warping effect. It does seem, though, that as time goes on, the Backrooms gets better at emulating these things, possibly. The appearance of the hotel, or the living room for instance, all of these things are certainly off, but they do seem to be in the field of what Async wanted, a solution to all storage problems by
finding
space rather than through natural means. Something else that seems to be clear about the Backrooms and further adds credit to this idea of it trying to emulate parts of human life is also in the way that it randomly creates or even pulls in other objects. This definitely is strange because we know the Backrooms were
found
specifically to just
have access to
new space, so why are there already things filling in that space? It's possible that these could be objects from our own reality that were warped into the Backrooms. I mean, not too long ago we just saw that yes, a car can in fact clip into the Backrooms, but maybe as well, it's trying to emulate the tools that we would need in certain situations, like the appearance of the axe and carts next to a house in the woods. When you think of a house in the woods, you definitely would expect to see tools like this due to the nature of the location, or the appearance of turn signs making sense in the neighborhood from pitfalls because that's emulating a more suburban area. Even if it doesn't quite do these things in a way that makes sense to us, it's almost like this neural network effect where the Backrooms is taking aspects of our lifestyle and trying to just throw it all together artificially, emulating it but still being off, not quite hitting the mark to make it make sense. And then there's also the matter of the no zones. What we know now is that there must be speculated places within the Backrooms that seem to act as holes within it, or rather rifts between it and our reality, which might be what's causing people to clip into the Backrooms by complete accident. This might add on to the idea that the Backrooms is almost pulling things from our reality into itself, including people, objects, and maybe even just sounds, like the chattering heard in informational video before the cameraman gets warped through time. The sound that was heard didn't seem to be heard by anyone else in that team, judging from their complete lack of response to the cameraman, but even then, the sound doesn't seem threatening.
Guys, can you hear this?
It just sounds like people in some kind of gathering, maybe at an office or a bar or what have you, where here there's just this odd space of carpet, floor, and wallpaper. There might just be a party or normal day of work going on in our reality in that exact spot, with only the sound of it leaking into the Backrooms. For all we know, it might even be capable of just pulling the entire planet into itself or something. It could be able to pull chunks of our own reality space into it. We don't know for sure, but the general consensus I'm getting is that anything is probably fair game for clipping into the Backrooms at this point. And not only that, but it seems that the Backrooms also has a way of existing outside of the normal flow of time. We know for sure in informational video that the cameraman had to have been warped forward to some point in time, and if he did walk through a null zone, that might be yet another consequence of it. being sent to the future or maybe even the past. And again, this isn't exclusive to people, because in Pitfalls there was that snippet of Kids by MGMT which came out a whole 17 years after the events of this video, adding in the appearance of a date that literally does not exist in informational video, and it's clear that the Backrooms can not only pull things from our reality, but it can pull things in from it from any given point in time, even well into the future. So I think the rules here seem pretty established with what we know so far. The uncanny nature of the Backroom seems to be a result of magnetic energies being manipulated so harshly that reality forces itself to send something to another place altogether. This manipulation of energy results in a lot of new space that takes a lot of similar traits to our own reality, but doesn't know how to arrange it in any way that would make sense to us. And due to the sheer amount of space that was
found,
holes have formed between our own reality and the Backrooms. Places where people or sounds or maybe even just random objects can end up clipping into it by sheer dumb luck. And the Backrooms itself seems to be aware of this, creating random other liminal spaces that try to replicate our reality to varying degrees of uncanniness. And due to the unstable nature of it, even being able to adopt certain aspects of our reality from any point in time. Almost like this singularity of things in our history just coming together into this one reality. And this brings us to the Beast. After seeing Pitfalls, it's clear that this thing is native to the Backrooms, but what is it, really? We never get enough of a good long look at it, and even with the closer shots we have, its form is very hard to discern. My theory for this, and the one that seems to be most likely, in my opinion, is that this is the Backrooms' interpretation of a person. And with what we know it can do, this seems to make a lot of sense to me. While not looking like a human whatsoever, its design is humanoid, having only a pair of arms and legs and having a sort of stick figure-like appearance and a head, despite it being rather difficult to really discern the appearance of. While it can move and bend in very unnatural ways, this is most similar in basic form to a humanoid, and when hearing the sounds that it makes, this works well in this idea's favor. It always makes noises that sound eerily human-like, even being able to say certain sentences, being able to scream much like a human, sounding as if it's in pain, and I think that much like the Backrooms learning by taking aspects of our own reality, the Beast seems to follow this principle. I touched on it when talking about Pitfalls, but listen to how the Beast speaks as the build-up to his appearance happens.
I think there's somebody down here.
What?
I hear yelling.
It's almost like it's cycling through different lines of dialogue, right? Saying the exact same things in the exact same tone over and over. I think that the Beast doesn't just make up these lines by itself because it makes no sense at all for its only words to just be crying for help only to run at whoever actually listens. You could say this is it trying to lure people in, but I think the more likely thing going on here is that these sentences are actually the words of people who it has encountered in the past, and it's mimicking those exact words. As it comes into contact with more people, it learns to mimic people better, including the screaming. I think it especially makes sense because, as I said before, even trying to listen to the rest of the yelling and other mutterings, it doesn't really make any comprehensible sense whatsoever, even with the few words I could gather.
Hey! Can you hear me?
Sorry, can you repeat that?
As if it's just hearing back the passing words of someone else who was in the Backrooms. And when comparing how it sounds in Pitfalls to the found footage, the Beast sounds much deeper in its tone of voice and screaming, not as human-like as it does in Pitfalls, but still sounding as if it's screaming in pain even though it's the one chasing Kane. It sounds more developed at that point, at least that's what it seems like to me. And I've gone this long without even mentioning just what the Beast really is, as in what makes it up in physical quality. This leads me into the next thing I want to look into, which is the matter of what happened to the John Doe and missing persons in autopsy report. We know that the person who died here was said to have likely died from malnutrition, which would make sense. I doubt that another thing like the Beast could have actually killed it, because if that was the case, there would be probably some kind of markings or injuries suggesting such a thing, and I'm sure that the forensic scientists would have noticed. But let's think about it. Looking deeper into the cause of death, we know the subject had what was best described as a mutated strain of hay bacillus in his digestive tract, which is supposed to be harmless, but ultimately seemed to contribute to the person's death and decomposition. And when going back to the video where the body was found, we can see he was surrounded and enveloped by some kind of mold. One of the researchers even thinking it might be some sort of fungus. Now, there's a lot of unknowns as to what really could have happened, but let's bring something else into this that might connect two things together, and this is actually a piece of information outside of the main videos. Going on Kane's Coffee, you can see some posted images from some videos and other things related to the series. The oldest image we can find here is one of the beast, actually. And its name? Simply just bacteria. There's still some unknowns to this, but I think I have an idea what might have happened. As I've mentioned, the Backrooms has a motif of trying to replicate certain aspects of our reality and pulling aspects of it into the Backrooms themselves. Now, while I don't know if the mold surrounding the dead body and missing persons is a creation of the Backrooms or if it's just already existing bacteria within the person being altered, I do think that the appearance of more people being in the Backrooms might have something to do with the beast's creation. Since all we have about it in name is just the word bacteria, my theory is that the beast is actually an amalgamation of a bunch of bacteria, specifically this mutated strain of Hay bacillus made into a very basic, sort of humanoid form. Bacteria do like to cluster into large groups and sometimes even forming into entire beings or what are called colonial organisms, and I do think this is an example of one, of the Backrooms using that concept to create this thing. And how I think it did that might have to do with the appearance of dead bodies within the Backrooms, and I think that because it allows the decomposition process to take place here, it introduces this bacteria into it for the Backrooms to learn from it, I suppose. So in a way, either the beast is a cluster of mutated bacteria that the Backrooms made up in its process to replicate the way that life in humans are made, or more eerie to me, it's an amalgamation of different people's bacteria being mutated and forming into a colonial organism. This might explain some of the things it can do, especially its ability of mimicking different people's voices and repeating very specific sentences. But that's my overall theory on what's going on with the beast and with whatever happened to the John Doe we saw in a few videos. It could definitely be wrong, and for all we know, there might be no relation whatsoever between these two things, but the one thing I do know for sure is the Backrooms, through some means, has a fucked up bacteria that had managed to mutate from one that is harmless in our reality and is causing a very unusual decomposition process as well as creating, well, this shit right here. But that's enough of that. There's still a few more things to address. Next, I want to focus on these messages. So far, there have been three interruptions in the videos that have this reverse text, all of which being very out of nowhere and very open to interpretation, but also seeming to act as an immediate response to something specific. The first time, it seemed directed at the man who died in missing persons. The second time, directed at the instructional video and almost mocking it, implying that it wouldn't do any good. And the third time, alluding to whatever Mark found at the other side of the door in Pitfalls, possibly. I mentioned how this brings a whole other factor into account, and that being that now aside from what we see in the videos themselves, I think it's also important to take into account possibly the more meta aspects of it. Not necessarily in breaking the fourth wall, but rather, for what reason are these messages here other than to be directed at the person viewing the videos? And this brings me to immediately ask, who was leaving these messages, and more importantly, do the videos being uploaded in this way have anything that might give us some foresight into what might happen later in the series? And this leads rather well into my final question, which goes sort of hand in hand with these messages, and it has to do with what exactly might happen in the series going forward in the timeline, eventually leading up to the found footage. We still have no idea just how bad things might end up being by the time 1991 rolls around in the story, our only idea of it being what we saw in the very first video of the series. But in that video, there's no mention of Async whatsoever. It's just Kane, alone, exploring these spaces and being chased and eventually taken by the beast at the end. We don't know who found the camera or how much people outside of Async might know about the Backrooms, but I don't doubt that the person who inserted these messages was someone that knew about all of this but also is aware of what is to come in the future. Keeping in mind, we know the Backrooms is capable of sending people to different points in time, mainly into the future, and my best guess as to who this person is that's leaving these messages is that this is someone who was in the Backrooms, got jumped forward in time and saw some shit we really aren't expecting yet, and managed to come back to insert these messages, almost as a warning for what's to come. And it's not like this is the only instance either of any party having doubts about the Backrooms or about Async as a whole. There is a very real theme, in my opinion, that is focused on in this series, and it has to do with the idea of seeing things that we probably just shouldn't. The TV at the end of Autopsy Report, for instance, seeing what might be a contract termination notice, as well as seeing an excerpt of what looks like someone condemning Async's project altogether and probably trying to persuade them to stop what they're doing at once. Then mankind simply was not meant to see the backrooms in the first place. While we still don't know enough about the person leaving these messages to be sure of who they are exactly, I think one thing can be made clear. They more than likely know things that we don't yet, and they might even be responsible for some of the videos being presented in the way that they are. Some videos do have a main focus, but then cut to something else. After all, informational video only actually has a proper informational video playing for like the first minute or two, and the rest is another video of what happens to a researcher who wanders off on his own. It's easy to just see it as using the informational video as a tone setter and just, you know, keeping things relatively cinematic in feel, but I can't help but think that some of these cuts to things that are not as related to the main idea or title of the video all have a way of trying to get across a very specific message to us. And that brings me back to a few things I only mentioned a while ago, but now it feels important to mention. Ever since First Contact, the thread that can be followed through in all of these videos to me is that everything that has happened since opening the gateway to the backrooms is, more or less, consequences of Async's meddling with the fabric of reality. The earthquake, the skyrocketing of missing persons cases, potentially losing funding from the government, falling under scrutiny for continuing the project, having bacteria mutate into a horrifying creature. Even if they have been insistent on making sure this information stays within Async only, even hiding it from other departments of Async since the person studying the body in autopsy report wasn't even told that the subject was found at the backrooms, hell, for all we know, he might not even be aware that it exists. It doesn't change that what happened was a direct result of Async's work, which only makes the reverse hidden messages stick out even more. As if someone actually wants Async's doings to get out to more people. Even in First Contact, we see that the backrooms only really came into fruition because one of the researchers refused to shut down the threshold. And this theme of Async's recklessness also seems to be consistent, with some occasions of researchers opting to avoid safety precautions in the name of meeting their goals. And more often than not, resulting in them getting themselves into very unfortunate situations, even if they do learn something new at the end of it. What becomes clear is that this project in nature is Async messing with something they really shouldn't. And while this might be a reach, even the project name could have something to do with that, KV-31. Searching that up brings you to the Valley of the Kings near Luxor, Egypt. KV-31 is an actual tomb there, and it was made only for the burial of Egyptian pharaohs built deep within the earth, and it was being described as also having a very similarly confusing structural design, sort of like the backrooms does. And within the tomb, three men and two women were found buried. And I think this actually has some merit because it's such a specific name to use for this project, but also, go back to missing persons. Who do we see on the posters? Three men and two women. Not even accounting for the fact that their bodies to some capacity are preserved and decomposition is stunted, which one could make a comparison with this to how dead bodies were preserved at the time in these tombs. And throwing the scent off script, using the new enlisted video as more evidence of this, it does seem to be a running theme now for Cain to kind of use outside sources to sort of strengthen some of the themes of the series, like how the new enlisted video refers to the yellow wallpaper. There's definitely like a running theme of using stuff like that to sort of aid in like going into these themes of like the backrooms like actively deteriorating the reality and the mind, and also like the backrooms being this place that's not really meant to be roamed or discovered in the first place. So in the grander scheme of the series, my ultimate theory on what this really is trying to focus on is taking a more eldritch perspective on the backrooms. Much like that team I mentioned, in the context of the series, the backrooms are not meant to be roamed. Maybe they've even existed well before we discovered them, but they are meant to be left undisturbed. We can't just explain the nature of it because it itself is beyond our understanding. We can use whatever science, math, or logic we want to try to understand what's happening or what their purpose is, but we'll be always left confused and unable to truly grasp everything happening because this reality does not work at all by the rules of ours. We still don't know what the hell was going on at the end of motion detected with that floating form, for instance.
If you showed a forensic scientist the body from the backrooms, not even they can really make much sense of it because of bacteria that does not exist otherwise in our reality. And I think this reinforces why we even see real events or real science or math used in the series. It's not to try to make it seem like this is real or to actually need to understand complex physics in order to know what's going on, but rather it puts into perspective how incomprehensible the backrooms really are. The point of seeing all of this terminology and attempts at explaining the backrooms is to prove that it can't be explained, or else you're just going to dig yourself into the same hole that Async seems to have found themselves in. Essentially, I don't think the goal of the series is to get all of the answers on why the backrooms works the way that it does, but rather it aims to focus more on the consequences of Async's actions and how it affects our reality as a result.
And it's because of this recklessness on their part on multiple occasions, and because of their insistence to meet their goals and take their technology to the furthest extent imaginable, that people have gone missing, have died, and that there's now a mutated strain of an otherwise harmless bacteria that has created something truly horrifying. An abomination as a result of a place that is trying as hard as it can to learn what reality it just crossed over with. And had it not been for people like Ivan Beck, who didn't stop to think if manipulating the essence of our own reality was going to have major repercussions, a place like the Backrooms would have simply been left undiscovered as it should have been, and no one would be put in any danger. If anyone, blame him. And one more thing. There was something I wanted to come back to. It's a really minor detail, but something that stuck out to me when I saw it. You remember the tape archive video? The one that was linked unlisted to the found footage? I mentioned that while the date of the archive was March 11, 1990, the description specifically mentioned that it was compiled on June 1991. Why exactly is something this precise here? It got me thinking, and I have an idea that might be a reach, but it's worth mentioning. Considering this is an archive that was compiled over a year after the file name date suggests, this is the only thing related to 1991 that we have aside from the found footage, and in there, we saw nothing related to Async, only the appearance of the beast. And it made me think, compiling something like that so late, there had to be a reason for it, right? And so, here's what I propose. As I've mentioned, everything that has happened regarding the backrooms in this series has been pretty much consequences for Async's meddling, at the cost of other people's lives and Async's integrity. While things don't seem to be building up too much yet away from Async's favor, I get the feeling that as things continue to escalate, especially with the uploading of report where we saw Async immediately try to do something to work around the threat that they just discovered in Pitfalls, things might get a little more heated for them. And come 1991, I think things are going to get very interesting. I don't know for sure, but what I am saying is, I'd keep a good eye on June 1991. I get the feeling that something might happen around that point of the timeline that would warrant someone deciding to compile an archive of some of this information. Maybe someone just wanted to make a backup and it doesn't actually mean that much, but I wouldn't doubt that somewhere around this point in time, all the consequences that I mentioned are going to come back around to bite Async pretty hard in the ass. And I'm excited to see if that ends up being the case or not, frankly. But we still have quite a gap in time before we get there, and an even larger one before we get to 1996, where the found footage was claimed to be found. But for all we know, there could even be stuff well in the past before the Backrooms' creation that we haven't seen yet. But I think that's all. Ultimately, we can't know for sure because this series is definitely not anywhere near completion from what I can tell, and I am more than ready for this all to be dated and for a lot of new factors to kick in that'll flip this entire analysis upside down. But with what we have at the moment, I'd say I've done the best I could analyzing this series in its current state, and all I really want to do now is try to take an even bigger step back. So, I think it goes without saying, this series is just
utterly phenomenal, and I've never in my life seen a web series take off this sharply. Even the growth of something like Marble Hornets pales by comparison. When I first saw the original found footage video, Kane had maybe 100,000 something subscribers, I think, and the video had like a little over a few million. Now it sits at almost 29 million views and still going up rather quickly, and Kane Pixels is approaching 1.4 million subscribers and has gotten a gold play button. It's utterly staggering, and I've gone this whole time without even mentioning he's done all of this at the age of 16, which is just wow. I can't help but give this series a ton of praise because it's really truly pioneered something that feels beyond my own imagination. The level of production quality in this series has been consistently mind-boggling to me, and even looking at something like Pitfalls, while the found footage still holds up really well, I can see Kane only getting better at nailing the realism and the overall look of the backrooms further, and it's one of the most impressive feats I think I've ever seen in really anything if we're talking about web series as a whole. The guy's a fucking magician, honestly. You could tell me that this is all like in a real location somewhere, and I may as well just believe you at this point. And it doesn't stop at the video editing and 3D rendering either. Most of the music I've been using for this video, this is also his work, and I'm absolutely going to link to both the main channel and his side one in the description because it accompanies the visual aspect of the series perfectly, in my opinion, mixing ambience and synth-heavy material to create something that's both like tense and also eerie and desolate. And there's a healthy mix of tracks that are absolutely playing into the isolating feeling of being in the backrooms, and some that get really intense, and a good chunk of these tracks haven't even been used in the series yet, which makes me curious how they're going to pop up in the future, if ever. Overall, just wow. Like, I'm sure a lot of what I'm saying is not like the first time anyone's ever said it, but it is not often that something hooks me this much to the point of writing like an over 40-page script talking about him, digging into it as much as possible. It's succeeded in having a good momentum the whole way through by not just relying on its nearly photorealistic production quality, but by leaving so much open still to the lore of the series and adding a genuine layer that ties the series down to our reality, as well as like incorporating more sci-fi elements on top of the horror elements that one would expect from a series about the backrooms. I feel it definitely succeeds in that aspect by not giving away too much about the backrooms, because I feel like it can be definitely hard to strike that balance with adding stuff to it without sacrificing the inherently mysterious and almost like eldritch-like nature that it gives off in concept, but this series masters it perfectly. I've noticed as well that the series even sees improvement in more of its character writing, mainly in Pitfalls. Having the team exploring the backrooms here be given like actual names and personalities sort of for most of the members, and seeing how they communicate to each other and act on their own volition, there's such a real aspect to even that now that's only further nailed by the really good acting on especially Marvin's part. And honestly, wherever it goes, I'm very excited to see how things turn out. While a few new videos were already uploaded while I was doing the audio, I do definitely get the feeling from report that this is just like the beginning of shit getting only more intense for Async, judging from how high quality report was. And aside from this main series, I also feel like addressing just the sheer impact that the series has had on YouTube. There's already a ton of videos that aim to replicate the effects and techniques that Kane used to make the backrooms look so effective in his series, and honestly, some people have already come up with some really cool shit so far, and I've even seen videos of this style from before Kane made the found footage video, which was rather interesting, and it also looks amazing. There's clearly an audience now for this sort of stuff, and with my experience watching web series, this actually reminds me a lot of the Slenderverse. Like, honestly, the Backrooms is pretty much the next iteration of something related to internet horror that has reached the level of popularity that the Slenderman has in like this like exact kind of way. It's like if Slenderman was a location, essentially. You have a general concept that gave people a lot of open space to work with, and not super long after that concept, something takes full advantage of it in video form and blows up, and now you see a bunch of people aiming to follow in its footsteps. I'm calling it, there's gonna be a Backrooms verse in the future with different series involving it crossing over with each other. If it doesn't already exist, that is. And I think that's all I really have to say overall. This script is long enough, or video rather, or whatever, but I've generally covered everything I wanted to in this first video I wanted to do for this channel. At the moment, I want to say that I will do another video on this series once enough videos come out, and by enough, I mean probably like around the same amount that are out right now, so like about 10 to 12 videos at a time maybe, or until it reaches a proper end at any point, but I frankly don't know because I have no idea what I'm gonna be up to in that time, so we'll just have to see. If Kane happens to be watching this video, thank you for listening to my over like 1.5 hour long ramble about your series. It's fucking amazing, and it makes me honestly really happy to see people's stuff getting the credit it deserves, and you definitely know what you're doing with this, so I'll be sure to support whatever you'll be up to in the future, backrooms related or not, just keep it up, for real. And thank you all in general for watching this video if you've made it this far. I don't really know how this video will turn out, honestly. I'm not expecting it to really get any crazy reception, I just felt like doing this, but I've always wanted to make videos revolving around things that I found super interesting, and I frankly don't know what I'll be up to next, but I hope you enjoy my rambling, even if I'm sure it'll be completely dated by like, I don't know, give it take like a few weeks, maybe a month. I guess that's the fun of it though, I like being wrong on things, and I'm excited to see what I might come up with when it comes to theories once we get even more pieces to whatever puzzle is being made here. The whole series, as well as any music that I use, both by Kane and by whatever other artists I use, will be in the description, and if I get any updates on certain transcripts for specific parts of some videos, thanks to anyone in the comments, I'll make sure to update the description with said transcript and crediting the person who did it. Also, as I mentioned earlier, Kane has a coffee, and while I already mentioned that you should definitely go support his stuff if you haven't already, I'm sure if you have any money to spare, supporting him financially would also go a long way. I'll be keeping an eye on this series for sure in the future, but for the time being, I've said everything I could, really. I'm sure there's other things I'd like to get to covering at some point, and maybe once enough videos in the future are out, I'll be sure to revisit it and give my new take on things. But I guess that's all I have to say. Thank you for watching, and if you want to see more stuff from me, you could shoot me a sub to stay notified about whatever I might make in the future. Either way, I just like talking about what I'm super into, whether it's games or web series related or even something else. I also have another channel for any of the weirder shit that I do that doesn't really delve into video essay territory, and it includes music, memes, what have you, just all the more spontaneous stuff, so feel free to take a look there if you want. This was Molly, and I'll see you later.